Jonathan Agnew, and welcome to the Test Match Special podcast, looking back on the third day of the third England-Pakistan test here in Southampton. Pakistan were fighting back today until James Anderson took five wickets, eventually. To come, we'll get reaction from the Pakistan captain, Azhar Ali, who played so well, and England's Dom Bess. The third day of the final test between England and Pakistan here at the Aegeus Bowl sees Pakistan bowled out for 273, and they're following on 310 runs behind, but they haven't faced a ball yet at that second innings, because as soon as all the players went out into the middle, the umpires decided that the light was too bad, and they took them off. An eventful day in lots of ways. Jimmy Anderson finishes on for 598 wickets. He should have had his 600, because he had three catches dropped, two in one over. And even by Jimmy's standards, I think that was a bit of a challenge for him to remain. But actually, he did remain pretty cool, pretty calm. He took the first one of the day. Shafiq was caught by Root at first slip after six runs being added for five. That was 30 for four. Fawad Alam made 21. He got a beautiful ball from Bess that turned, bounced, and was very, very well caught indeed by Jos Buttler standing up. He had a long way to go, to go up and to his left. So that was the end of Fawad. Then the main stand of the day, 138 between Mohammad Rizwan and the captain Azhar Ali. And Rizwan was eventually caught down the leg side by Buttler off Wokes for 53. The captain still going strong at this stage. Yasser Shah made 20. He was very well caught by Joe Root when the new ball was taken off the bowling of Broad. It went really quickly and high above his head at first slip. It was a terrific catch, that. Broad also had Shane Afridi caught. Brilliant catch by Jos Buttler, one-handed, absolute full stretch down the leg side, and the ball was just in the tip of his fingers, and he knew if he landed on that hand from the dive, there's a chance the ball might bounce out of his glove. You often see that. So while he was, just before he landed, he just loosened his grip on the ball, allowed it to drop into the palm, and then close his fist around it. It was a brilliant, brilliant piece of wicket-keeping. Then the shambles with the drop catches and so on, including Azhar Ali. He was dropped twice. Burns put him down. Mohammad Abbas was dropped by Crawley at slip. So those are the... Anderson managed to virtually keep it together. But then Azhar Ali hit him to mid-on. It went to Stuart Broad's waist, just to his right. He dropped it. And just as everyone thought, oh no, here comes another violent explosion, in a rage himself, Broad just got hold of the ball and hurled it at the stumps and happened to rip the middle one out of the ground with Mohammad Abbas out of his ground. It was an amazing piece of cricket. I mean, it was comedy in so many ways. But again, Anderson denied what would have been his third wicket. That would have been number 600. But he's had to deal with and simply settle for his 598th, when he had Nasim Shah caught by Sibley for naught. He's taken his 29th five-wicket haul, 5 for 56. Stuart Broad took 2 for 40. Wokes and Bess a wicket each, and Jofra Archer was wicketless for 58. So lots going on. There's a period there, Michael, where, I don't know, with the forecast around, it looked as if Pakistan might be able to see out the day, go into tomorrow. We know that Tuesday looks to be a bit of a write-off and possibly save the game, but they've got a long day ahead of them tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of look at Pakistan. I think when they lost that early wicket this morning, I don't think there was many in the ground around the commentary boxes that didn't think they were going to just fall in a heap.
Yeah.
You know, I think the conditions were in England's favour, and all of a sudden Azhar Ali came out there, and straight away you could see that his technique had changed. That left foot wasn't quite going over to the offside, his balance was better, he could access those straighter deliveries. He played a few glorious shots on the inside to get himself going, and in Mohammad Rizwan he found a fighter, you know, a great character to bat with, and that partnership was special for Pakistan. England kept on nipping away. The spinner and Jos Buttler's combination worked. Delighted for Buttler behind the stumps, because he's taken three really good catches. That one down the leg side to Stuart Broad, the flying right hand, the one off Dom Bess, you know, one off Chris Wokes down the leg side, very similar to the one that he dropped off Jermaine Blackwood just a few weeks ago here on this venue. So it's been a good day for Buttler. You know, Azhar Ali's a standout for Pakistan, but it's amazing. I remember today for those three drop catches in 10 balls.
I've just seen them while you were talking. They've just shown them on the screen. And how Anderson has managed to hold it together. And such an irony that that Stuart Broad would have dropped his 600. I mean, how does that work out as well?
Oh, it was just comical, wasn't it?
It's so comical. And you see the ball hurled in rage from Broad, ripping out the stump. And one of the highlights for me was the looks on the faces of Joss Butler and Joe Root, because they didn't look at Jimmy. And there's a wicket fallen, and no one knew what to do. You couldn't really celebrate it, because it should have been Jimmy's 600.
And then you saw Mohammed Abbas's face. He was surprised he was run out. He was run out by 5 metres.
It was a mad moment, and it's nice that there's occasionally some comedy to go. I don't know how much Jimmy's ribs are necessarily being tickled at the moment, but anyway, he's been around a long, long time, and he knows his chance will come in this second innings to get the two that he now needs. Azza, how do you reflect on Pakistan's day there? They 30 for four, it didn't look good.
It wasn't look good, and as Michael mentioned, you know, Azhar Ali and Mohammad Rizwan, standout performance from these guys, and especially Azhar Ali under so much pressure, so much scrutiny, and the way he batted today and leading the team from the front. And good thing we saw him coming back for opening the batting.
Yes, that was interesting, wasn't it? I was in favour of that.
Yes, I need to ask you, what is the rule? Because ball hasn't been bowled, and he crossed the rope, and he can bat.
I think he's crossed the rope. Once you come out over that rope, because that's the interesting thing about it, isn't it? Now you've got your prime batsman in great form. I could see why he opened the batting tonight. Tomorrow he's going to start fresh.
I thought it was the right decision. I think, you know, because enough experience in the coaching staff, Bakar, Mushi and all these guys, you know, and they said, you face the ball, you know, two new balls, and why don't you go and face the third new ball? And it was right decision from Pakistan point of view. I think he played really well with Rizwan. He's a fighter. We saw he got hit by the Jofra Archer, and next ball, you know, everything was behind the ball, and he played really well. He showed some good courage and temperament and everything.
Isn't it sort of good from a player's perspective when you can prove points to your critics? It's a phrase I don't really like to use, because there wouldn't have been criticism usually unless, you know, without reason. But with all the noise that's been going on in Pakistan, Safaraz in Rizwan's case, and obviously this Azhar Ali seems to be copying it from all sorts of areas at the moment. And you know, Rizwan's had a terrific tour, isn't he? I mean, that is a really good decision that he's come in to replace Safaraz. As an impartial observer, not involved in Pakistani cricket politics, he is a terrific cricketer. He really he's got a really strong character. And for Azhar Ali, again, who you've described is copping so much back at home, to bat like that in these conditions, the light's been pretty awful all day. He's held that innings together.
It was tough, tough condition. Yesterday, when he was batting, Jimmy Anderson and Broad was bowling with Archer. And this morning as well, it was tough, tough condition. It wasn't easy condition any time. You know, ball was doing enough. And he showed some great class, and he proved his critic wrong in back home in Pakistan. And Rizwan as well, you know, everybody was saying, why do you drop the captain? And he was brilliant throughout the series with his keeping and batting as well. We saw in the last game, you know, when ball was hooping around and the way he batted with the tail, it was phenomenal.
Yeah, it was. How do you assess Azhar's
innings? Well, I just think that's proof that when you just iron out something technically and you go and deliver it out in the middle, I'm sure over the course of the last week or so, you know, there was a lot of time probably to go in the indoor school throughout that second test match. And that left foot not going over to that offside and the head not following, or the head going first and the leg following, whichever way you want to call it. You know, once you get out in the middle and you feel that movement's perfect and you can access those straight balls, you just feel so much relief as a player. I had it so many times in my career that 3 or 4 innings would go and I'd not score, and I'd be like, what's going wrong? And I'd go and work on a movement to make sure that I was in a more neutral position that I can access full balls, get, you know, back into the ball, go forward and back with balance. And it's the most wonderful feeling in the middle when you know it's nice, because you don't fear any deliveries. And when you're playing like Azhar Ali played today, the ball that nips back, which is his danger ball and has been, you know, he could access those balls that were nipping back. And there was one or two earlier that Stuart Broad ball and just nipped back. And because his foot wasn't in the way, his back could access towards the line of the ball and he got away with it. It was the odd ball that hit the inside edge and went down to fine leg. And it's a wonderful feeling as a batsman when you get that you know you've worked it out and you've gone probably with Yunis Khan or Misbah into the nets, and he's worked technically so hard, and you know he's a wonderful player.
Yes, like, he is.
His game on the leg side, and that's why it's amazed me for a while watching him, of why he does take that foot over to the offside, because realistically his game should be leave, make the ball straight and go, thank you very much, onto the onside. That's when Azhar Ali's at his best, like we saw today.
Because of his knee, because this is a problem he had in Australia when I was with the team as well, and last year when Pakistan tour here, because of his knee, when his knees are really stiff, that's where he struggled a bit more, you know, he can't get the balance right, and that's where he struggled. If his knee is fine, ITBs are loose, and then he's fine. And definitely he worked with Yunus Khan, and because he's doing the normal practice, you know, like a underarm ball, so hitting that ball through mid-on area and mid-wicket area rather than, you know, going across and playing across the line.
Need to have a massage every time he bats, get those IT bands nuts and loose. That's
what they got the gun massage. Everyone has that these days.
Oh, well, that's obviously the.
But he's one of the good guys, Aggers.
Yes, he is.
You know, I like to see good people rewarded, yeah. And I think that there's no one in English cricket and world cricket that doesn't think that Azhar Ali is a really high-class individual.
He's a gent, and the interviews are all the time. He's always down there. He's always happy to be done. I go along with that, absolutely. And what about England slip-catching? I mean, it's been dire this summer, hasn't it?
Well, you've got to laugh because, I mean, they're all young. You know, you've got Zach Crawley. That was as easy as they come.
Yes.
I do worry about Rory Burns because he's had a tough summer with the bat. You know, when you're dropping catches at second slip, you know, it adds to that kind of negativity in his mind.
Yes.
At the end of a summer, he's not going to, I don't think, get another bat in this game. You know, you just hope he can grab a couple tomorrow and go away from this test series with a positivity of thought in his mind. You know, but the cordon's been a problem. Joe Root's been excellent. You know, I think Andy earlier on was talking about Joe Root's catching at first slip.
Let's talk about Butler, because obviously that was such a big theme of the last match, his wicket keeping. Well, I mean, he's taken two brilliant catches today.
Yeah, well, we kind of always saying, you know, runs in the bank, is it going to help his keeping? Well, clearly it has. And I don't think it's just the runs. I look at him technically, his foot movement down the leg side to the seamers, you know, more crab-like, he's getting across. Where if you even go back to the second test here, there was a couple of times down the leg side where he just didn't move. He just didn't feel he had those legs moving towards the leg side balls. Well, today he's taken two tremendous catches down the leg side, particularly like the catch off Don Best, because that's exactly the catch that he dropped 2 weeks ago, which shows to me that it's either that he's more relaxed and the hands are a little bit more giving to the ball, or he's worked tirelessly, without question, with Bruce French to just try and iron out a technical flaw or two.
And just briefly, as far as the winter's concerned, it's to see him having done the work and take a catch like that, does that make you think, you know, that actually...
Well, England have got options.
Yeah.
They've got so many options in subcontinent conditions. They've got Keaton Jennings that they like at the top of the order, potentially be coming in because he plays spin so well. They've got Ben Foulkes who could come in as a keeper, brilliant wicketkeeper, very good against spin as a batsman, got that 100 in Sri Lanka, and that would mean Butler plays as a batsman. The England Test Match team are starting to have lots of options. Nice headaches to have.
This is the TMS podcast from BBC Radio 5 Live.
Let's get some reaction then from both camps. First, the Pakistan captain and the century maker today, Azhar Ali, has been talking to Dan Norcross.
A great knock. We can see how much it meant to the team. It gave you a very rousing reception when he got that 100. How much did it mean for you?
Alhamdulillah, first of all, I would like to thank Almighty Allah. It meant for a lot for me. I was under pressure. But again, it needs to, you know, when you're under pressure, you need to keep things simple and focus what you can do best. You know, basics are very important, and you know, they were bowling really well last night and also this morning. So I wanted to fight out in there and hang in there as long as I can. As inning unfolded, I felt comfortable later on. It's nothing more than once you score runs, you got 50, then your confidence gets back. So yeah, it meant a lot for me, my team, all the guys and the management. They always behind me. They want me to do well. So that's why they were very happy.
A really terrific partnership with Mohammad Rizwan. You must be delighted at the tour he's been having, both with the gloves and the bat.
Yeah, wonderful. He's a positive person. Whatever the situation and the circumstances, always come with the positive intent. He played wonderfully today again. He showed the command, and also he was smart at the crease. He's a wonderful wicketkeeper, brings a lot of energy in the team, fantastic for us.
Now, the thinking of opening the batting, you were still in, so you were seeing it well. That was the theory, I guess, yeah?
Yeah, of course. In this kind of light, when lights are on and it's kind of dark, I was quite clear once someone said, can you go back? Ms. Bas said, and I said, yes, why not? The light was kind of this, and, I was playing the new ball as well, so I wanted to just continue from that, and let's see tomorrow morning what we decide again.
How did you decide between Abid Ali or Shaun Masood, who was going to partner you?
Right and left.
As simple as that?
Yeah, as simple as that, because it was three, four overs. Right and left combination, sometimes the lines of the bowlers, you need to adjust, so that's why we went right and left.
And just who does make that decision? Was yours, or did somebody, so maybe the coach, say, are you up for it? Can you do it?
No, like when I went upstairs, obviously, there was some suggestion. I said I will go because I was feeling confident. I want to obviously make sure that we don't lose any wickets again tonight. And fortunately, the light was finally called.
Now, it's been a tough test, disappointing test for you guys. You lost a really important toss, it feels like, on that first day. There's still a draw to play for. Bad weather around on the last day, that must give you encouragement, doesn't it? It could be that you've got to survive maybe 100 overs.
Well, as long as we are fighting in the middle, we are happy. Results will take care of itself. If we bat well, anything is possible on this pitch. Once even a pair gets in, it looks sometimes very impossible to get a wicket. But, considering the English bowling lineup, you had to work hard. But we want to take small step at a time.
Azhar, it's a great knock. Two tough days to come, maybe, but we'll see. Well done. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
The TMS Podcast from BBC Radio 5 Live.
Well, that was Azhar Ali with Dan Norcross. And we should clarify that in theory, Azhar doesn't have to open the innings on the fourth day. Law 25.2 states that the innings of the opening batsman only start at the call of play, which didn't happen tonight. For other batsmen, it's when they enter the field of play. So by law, Azhar Ali doesn't have to open tomorrow as his innings hadn't started. So we'll wait and see what happens. Now, Dan also got some reaction from the England camp and spoke with the spinner Dom Bess.
Dom, it must be a relief to get bowling again after the last test match with the sort of clouds and the rain around. Just great to get the ball back in your hand, wasn't it?
Yeah, it is. Like I've just said then, I think it's been a funny one. Obviously, with the weather being around, it's been very seam friendly conditions. And you look at our squad of seamers in terms of what we've got, it's unbelievable, unbelievable talent. So I guess it's quite interesting as an English spinner, what my role is. Like you said, I am very happy to get the ball back in my hands and get bowling again. But in terms of the unit, whatever I need to do for the side, I'll try and do it as best as I can.
Well, with the follow-on being the option, and we know why, because of the weather at the forecast at the back end, that sort of brings your role into a sharper focus, doesn't it? Because those seamers who may be seen to do the bulk of the work, but they need time off. You may have quite a few shifts to come yet.
Yeah, hopefully. That's what I want as well. I want to be part of the unit. I want to be taking wickets. And I think going into day four tomorrow, I think it's a pretty good wicket in terms of the actual main pitch. But I certainly do think there's rough coming on. And there was a couple of balls even today that I got to bounce spit. Hopefully, as we go on, as the pitch wears, as we bowl more, I'll come a little bit more into the game.
You came a little bit round the wicket as well, because that obviously brings LBW into play. Is that a sign that they're maybe just starting to deteriorate a little bit, the surface?
Yeah, and also in terms of why I did it, obviously it was 70, sort of fifth, sixth over. I sort of came round then again as well to try and just tie them up, try and obviously get to the 80th over, do a bit of the donkey work, I guess, and just, do you know what I mean, just try and get there. But you see Yashir, obviously good ball, and he's nicked it through the slip. So in terms of a bit of, I guess, indecision in terms of it might spin a little bit, obviously you looked at the left hander and one sort of really did spit, so I guess coming round the wicket I've got that option of it kicking on and also spinning.
Now, England's fielding was flawless for much of the day. Two brilliant catches from Joe Root and exceptional catches from Joss Butler. And then there was a sort of a mad half hour. We could see Jimmy struggling with that. What do you put that down to?
Genuinely, it was very dark. It's no excuse in terms of catching it, but I don't... honest view is it was very dark out there and I was fielding square of the wicket. And I know, I think Jofra bowled one to Azam and pulled one and I did not see it in terms of that. And it was head high. God forbid it go anywhere, genuinely, at me, because I think it was proper dangerous. And obviously going into that, having number 10, 11 out there, when you got someone like Jofra bowling with a brand new ball, it is very dangerous in terms of the players. I know I'm all for getting the game going and getting it on, but I think as well at times we've got to be quite sensible. I think the reading out there was 430, the reading, and I think we came off last time for 700, and that 700's dark. We came off at 430. So it just shows you probably how low the light level was.
Well, yeah, it certainly did feel gloomy, and we've got the clouds rolling in now as we speak, and that's going to be perhaps one of the bigger issues for England over the next couple of days. First part of the mission's accomplished. Enforce a follow-on. How confident are you can finish it all off?
Yeah, very confident. And if we weren't confident, then we shouldn't be here, because I think, again, I know there's weather around, but even with that, you have breaks. I think it's much harder for the batters in terms of having those breaks, having those continuous breaks, having to try and get back in. Again, you look at our bowling attack, James Anderson, Stuart Broad, countless wickets, Jofra with his pace, Chris Wokes, his talent in England is unbelievable. And then hopefully I can get a couple as well on the end.
Just finally, a quick word on James Anderson. We upstairs in the commentary box sometimes fixate a little bit too much on milestones, but 600 is massive. Is the team aware of how massive that is? And you know, does it mean as much to you guys as it seems to us?
Yeah, 100%. 600 test wickets are an unbelievable achievement. And I think, again, even playing with him in terms of as a youngster watching him grow up, I know myself, Zach, Dom, Ollie have all grown up watching him play, and to even be stood out there, and I guess it would be for me as a fan of England cricket, I think it would be unbelievable that he takes 600. Everyone is obviously behind him trying to grab hold of the catches as well to make sure that happens, but he's England's greatest.
Dom, thanks so much. All the best of luck tomorrow.
Cheers. Thank you very much.